Colleagues, audiences, and friends, I would like to start by thanking my colleagues. I start with Professor Estevan for his kind invitation, and for the rector of the university for opening this conference, and to my good colleague. I don't say old colleague because it has implications, but my colleague, Professor Judith Kish, whom I know her for many years, and also Mr. Zabu Attila, for his help and organizing my schedule and coming and to be with you here today. And also, I would like to thank you also for being here and also for being for Africa. I think your presence here shows also your commitment to Africa and the fact that nowadays one can watch such speeches through the computer-mediated technology and uses it still to come and be present and interact with the audience. I think it's a very good sign for the interest that you have in Africa. The presentation today is about the issue of the decline of democracy and the decline of democracy in the world. So at least there is one difference in what we know about the decline of democracy or the lack of democracy in the past. Africa or most of the developing countries were the target. But today we are told that the decline of democracy is global. And therefore, I want to start by setting the scene for this global decline of democracy that you are talking about before I come to Africa. So I divide my time half-half. Half I use it for setting the stage, and the second half I will use in talking about the collapse, the crisis of democracy or the decline of democracy. Let me start like this. The decline of democracy is also known as a democratic recession, democracy in retreat, democratic crisis, democratic discontent, democracy under siege, democracy backlashing or backsliding. This is just to mention some few connotations of what we mean by the decline of democracy. But if you want to characterize it and explain it, in fact, it means some very concrete elements. And those elements are taken from institutional politics. Yeah? Institutional politics. As institutional politics, as we know it, the politics of the legislature, the politics of the executive, political executives, the formal politics, that is parliaments, political parties, all that type of discussion. So it means that we talk about issues that the state has failed to protect the fundamental freedoms of its citizens, and that the state has not done its part of the social contract in respecting the rule of law, conducting free and fair elections, respecting minority rights, freedom of the media and freedom of expression, and other liberties. So it means that the crisis, what we describe as a crisis of democracy, mean this type of characterization. In my view, this characterization, it is essence, not the crisis of democracy, but the crisis of the legitimacy of the state. Because the state itself is party to the decline of democracy. It is not that people are walking away from democracy and say, we don't want democracy, please bring us back the dictatorship. And that's why people go until today. They vote, they demonstrate, they protest, they do all what they can do. Why? Because they feel if democracy is under siege, democracy under siege in a situation where we are having a crisis of the legitimacy of the state. Not because democracy as an institution that regulates human affairs is something that people detest. The decline of democracy is a symptom of crises within the state. It's not a crisis within society. And if there are crises within society that are not against democracy and the democratic tide. I ask the question whether the debate on the crisis of democracy is new. I think it is not new. It often starts, people start talking about the crisis of democracy is when the institutions of democracy, which are state-centric, are dysfunctional. And I would like to start with the first elements of that crisis and when it has started. The crisis of democracy, we can go back and talk about it. Some of you have done philosophy. You can talk about the trial of Aristotle, and you know how he argued about the corrupt Athenian elite and so on. And so that's not. So it is an old debate. But I'm not going that way because we will not finish. I just want to start from the contemporary debate. The contemporary debate started in the period between the two wars, the First and the Second War. And one of the most lamenting books, and that I think you should, if you are interested in this subject, you should look at it. It is in the internet anyway, free of charge. A book published by the one Professor Cram, 1937. He called his book The End of Democracy. And for him, the end of democracy is in the process of accomplishment between the two world wars. Why is he saying that? Because during this period, there are three regimes that are very central to the European consciousness and this European personality that have challenged many of the values for which Europe stood historically. Of course, we start with Stalin. Stalin created state capitalism under the dictatorship of the proletariat, but in the name of communism. It is a state capitalism. The state controlled everything in the economy. And also, the state has infringed in the domain of citizens, which in every democracy, citizens' domain should be autonomous from the domain of the state. When the state starts interfering in the domain of citizens and try to organize citizens, say this and don't say that, subscribe to particular ideology, but not the ideology that is in your favor, that is infringing in the citizens' space, it means that the state is beginning to play a totalitarian role. So Stalin state was as oppressive as it is authoritarian. The second regime that is really thrived during the second, during the period between the two wars, is the dictatorship, of course, of Hitler and Nazism. And it is very much perpetuated by an oligarchy. That oligarchy combined the monopoly and domination of wealth and politics, but also with a very strong racial undertone. That is, when race is superior, is over alles, over everybody else. And that is a very, very concerning ideology. And of course, the third is fascism, both in Italy and Spain. And for the fascists, they proclaim that all for the state, nothing outside the state, and nothing and nobody against the state. Now, for Professor Cram to argue that democracy has come to an end, he called it the end of democracy. I think he is right at that time, because he thinks that with this sort of powerful regimes, don't forget the development in technology and science during this period is unsurpassed in the history of Europe and the history of the world. Because many of the technologies that we enjoy today, of course, started during that period. So the fear of Kramer is really a real fear. He has the right to say that. But fortunately, democracy is so resilient that those three regimes disappeared. And we had democratic Europe that has been able to thrive today after the two wars and created the European Union and so on and so forth. You know all of that. You are the citizens of this period. Democracy never died, despite the darkness within which Kram wrote his book between the two wars. But the debate did not discuss that. You know, over three decades later, in 1975, the United States of America established a commission. They called that commission the Trilateral Commission, because it deals with three continents: the United States, Asia, and Europe. The role of the commission is to assess the governability of representative democracy in Europe, because there was a feeling that democracy was in crisis. And of course, this period, the Americans have to say that democracy is crisis. That is a period of Watergate. Because the period of Watergate, McCarthyism, all different kinds of issues. It is a period of the Vietnam War, the civil women rights, environmental rights, all different kinds of issues that they felt that, you know, this representative democracy is not able to cope with these issues. And therefore, it is in trouble. We have to establish that commission in order to give us guidance on how to reorientate and structure representative democracy in new ways. And the commission, I think, asked a very pertinent question. Is the democracy that we have, or they had in Europe during 1970s, viable for form of government for the industrialized countries? They questioned, is this form of democracy viable and relevant, still relevant to the democratizing countries? Their answer is simple, no. It is not relevant, because they see all the problems with democracy around them. And therefore, they argue that democracy in its representative form and its institutions require significant reforms and restructuring to offer a viable system of government for the 20th century. Questioning. Okay. Again, democracy rebounds. During the 90s, we have what we call the third wave of democratization or democracy. We have probably the period in the world from the 90s until today, we have the largest number of democratic states in the world. Whether they are functioning or not, that's a different question. Whether democracy is declining or not, that's a different question. But we have more democratic countries in the world today than before 1990. Again, democracy showed resilience. Not only survived, came with a bang. In a continent like Africa, where you have only less than 10 countries that you can call them democratic or quasi-democratic or free or half free or something like that, almost the whole continent, apart from few countries that have problems. But the debate did not discuss, did not finish. It did not take very long. Just within one debate from that time, John Keane, the big commentator in politics, he wrote his first book. He wrote his very big book, I could call it, but he think it is small. He call it a pocket book that you can put in your pocket. It is 800 pages. And the title of that book is The Life and Death of Democracy. Big. So what he did is that he traced the rise and fall of democracies and empires from the early history of civilization and empires to date. He also documented the most recent expansion of democracy, representative democracy, from Europe to the rest of the world. Keane laments that representative democracy alone, does not or no longer capable of satisfying citizens' eagerness for new forms of democracy, mainly drawn from the current development of human history. So democracy has to renew yourself to become relevant to new generations of people whose ideas about democracy are different from those of their grand-grand parents. This debate was taken up by the major democracy indices in the world. I'm not going to talk about all of them, but I want to talk about two only for contrast. And from here, I will start talking about Africa. So just to conclude the first part, I want to say that the ideas and debates about the decline of democracy are not new. They are old. And democracy always went into eclipse. And when the times when democracy goes for eclipse, it is not the problem with democracy. It is a problem of the crisis of the legitimacy of the state. The state is dysfunctional in one way or another. Now, come to the indices. Now, before that, let me come to the major publications in the world about democracy, what you call the Journal of Democracy, 2015. They had a very big, very special issue dealing only with the issue of the decline of democracy. I don't want to say much about that, but the authors of that special issue included the big guys in the field of democracy, you know? Larry Diamond and Mark Plata and Thomas Catherwood and Fukuyama and Robert Keegan, and even, you know, from the policy domain, you know, Susan Rice and so on and so forth. And it is very surprising, because these are the same guys who were responsible for the promotion of democracy. Now suddenly they came and told us, you know, government spent these millions or billions of dollars for you to promote democracy, and now you are the first one to come and tell us democracy on decline? What have you been doing? Huh? Just leave it there. The second one is the issue of foreign affairs. Of course, the Journal of Foreign Affairs is considered the preserve of the best in the business of unlocking future political trends and inform world-class policy and decision makers. So it is really, you can call it even the mouse speaker of the democratic, particularly in the United States. It informs the United States policy. And the people, you can write about it, but you don't talk about the United States, your paper will not be published. You have to say what is the implications of your paper for the United States. And in that particular issue, Larry Diamond, in fact, his own journal, the Journal of Democracy, was established during that period in order to promote democracy. What was he saying? He was saying that democracy itself seems to have lost its appeal. Hopes for freedom, security, and economic growth, just as the world's established democracies, including the United States, have grown increasingly dysfunctional. Again, Fukuyama asked, just I give you a flavor of it, ask, why is democracy performing so poorly? He questioned whether we are experiencing a momentary, something just a momentary transition or transit, setback in a general movement toward greater democracy worldwide, or whether this signals a broader shift in the world politics and the rise of alternatives to democracy. That's what he was saying. Now, so it is plausible, if you look at these three periods, that the so-called decline of democracy associated with decline, either in the world affairs generally or as or the state becomes more dysfunctional. Now, where did they pick up this idea that they just discovered that democracy is in crisis and why? I think for me, the best person who wrote about the reasons why democracy is in decline globally, not only Africa, at least for a change, he said that there is a growing sense that advanced democracies are in trouble in terms of their economic and political performance. They are not performing very well. That is why democracy is in decline. Then he say, there is a new self-confidence and seeming vitality of some authoritarian countries, that some authoritarian countries began to perform very well, particularly economically. And his third point is that the shifting geopolitical balance between the democracies and their rivals. And therefore, like Thomas Carstairs, he noted that democracies travails in both United States and Europe have significantly damaged the standing of democracy in the eyes of many developing countries and many people around the world. He said key to this is the success of China, the economic success of China, while it is not a democracy. And this made so many elite think that probably the authoritarian way of development would get us much faster to where we are going than the prevailing democracy. For him, it is a suspicion. He's not saying that I believe in it, but he said, what I see in front of me, the fact that some authoritarian regimes were able to outsmart all democracies is a problem. Because if China can achieve in 40 years what Europe has achieved in 400 years, under authoritarianism, there must be something in authoritarianism that some developing countries are thinking about. Okay, but of course, it's not the reality. As far as I know, Africa, the closest to China in terms of economic development and so on and so forth, African countries never forsaken their democracies because they just have to follow the Chinese. So, in fact, no, I don't know of any African country that has taken the Chinese Communist Party model as a system of organizing their political affairs. They are Democrats in the way that we understand democracy. So what is the difference between the decline of democracy today and what in the past we talk about as the democratic recession in Africa or the lack of democracy or authoritarian Africa? So the failure of democracy in Africa in the past was explained against the backdrop of several factors. There is issues of the politics of the belly. Hungry people cannot be good Democrats. Patrimonialism. Lack of social and cultural embeddedness of democratic values in society. Religious and ethnic cleavages and differences, among other factors. However, these factors existed prior or before the current debate on the crisis of democracy. They were already there. Democracy rebounds. And everybody was saying, oh, they tick all the boxes, democracy in Africa is very healthy. And these things have not disappeared. So you cannot blame them also for the decline. Because the 10 or 15 years or so where democracy was very thriving in Africa, these factors have not disappeared. So you cannot blame them for Africa being undemocratic. It means that Africa was democratic even with the existence of these. If we believe that they exist, okay, they exist, but still, there was a very close to 2 decades of very good democratic resurgence and democratic development in Africa, and everybody was happy about the political development in Africa. So you cannot blame this today for the decline of democracy, because they are persistent in the history of Africa. But why is it that then there is something going up and then going down? It's not this, there is something else. And again, this something else probably, it has to do with global issues. It has to do with the state. It has to do with people's perception of democracy. Because I think one of the major mistakes that has happened is that there is a conflation of democracy and development. Telling people, if you become a Democrat, you develop. People waited 5 years with democracy, they did not. 10 years, there is something called Africa rising and God knows what, and after years, 5 years, they told you after Africa is coming down. That conflation also created a suspicion in people that probably this conflation or linking the two, maybe it's problematic. Maybe if you have development, you can conserve it and make it more sustainable through democracy. But don't say that if you are democratic, then you develop. Yeah, well, of course, if that is the case, India should rule the world anyway. They say they have the biggest democracy today. People like democracy, but the development in India is not something that make you so excited that it is because it is democratic, it has done that. So what are the indices say? Now we come to the indices. What the indices say? Yes, this is good. Oh, you are really following me very carefully. I have to be also very careful, you know. You see, here this is the index is taken from Freedom in the World. And this is particularly in the period between 2010 and 2019. And they show you that in terms of Africa, there is 11% of the country, 16% of the countries are free, 43 are partly free, and 41 are not free at all. But of course, what makes you a little bit suspicious is about Eurasia. They say that there is no free country in that continent. They are only they are only partly free, and there are ones who are not free at all. So I think they score very bad. And of course, the Middle East also has its problems. These are the two, only the two regions that are worse than Africa. Then, of course, Africa is number three. Can you have it in the graphic presentation? So this is how it is now, how it looks like that. Of course, the old democracies of Europe and the Americas are doing very well. The Asia-Pacific, Sub-Saharan Africa up there. Anyway, if you look at the world averages, Africa is below the world average. And many other countries, of course, are below the world average. Okay, now, what does this mean? It means that democracy, in fact, is treated technically. There is a technical machination, meaning that Africa is, democracy is just like economics. It is bust and booms. If you get your GDP, if you get all the structural fundamentals of your economic rights, then your economic will thrive. So you have a boxes, you take all the boxes. If you do all of these things, you have a prescription. If you do all of these things, your democracy is fine. But if some of these things are missing, then your democracy is not good. So you quantify democracy. And I have a problem with the quantification of democracy. Because I think democracy means more than the figure that you assign to it. And mind you, these figures are not real. These are perceptions. And perceptions taken from very few influential people in different sectors of the society. These are very much, in a sense, is very much subjective. Now, there is a second index that I wanted to show you. And this index somehow agrees with the Freedom House, Freedom in the World index. But it shows completely different results because also they do the calculations. It means that, of course, if you are in good statistics, you can lie with the statistics, you know. You choose the variables that give you the results you want. But I'm not that cynical to say these people just got the result they want. Maybe they are genuinely trying to do it. But maybe the method they are doing is bad. That is another thing. Can you go to the next one? Yeah. And this one here, this is called the African Governance Index. Ibrahim Governance Index. It is one of the most elaborate indices, because he does not talk about the world. He just takes Africa. And he really went through so many things. I think they have, hundreds of indicators and tens of variables. And they said, okay, in terms of security of rule of law, Africa is something like minus 7%. Minus 7, in the way you said, it is close to 7%. And participation, rights, and inclusion, it is minus 1, that's about 14%, if you want to translate it to the other in this. But you look at the foundations of economic opportunities, Africa is 4.1, and the human development, then you have plus. Then at the end of it, you have the overall African governance is positive. Now the question is, how is it suddenly that a country where 41% of the country of the countries are not democratic suddenly become that you have a figure, it is positive by 12%? Now, for me, I'm not cynical to question everything that he said. Can I go to the graphic representation? I'm not knowing somebody to say everything is bad in the way they dealt with it. But it tells you something about this mechanical calculation of figures to prove democracy is there or not there. Why? Because the assumption here is that democratic practices reside in institutional politics, not the day-to-day politics that people practice. It is in institutional, when you go to institutional, that is democracy, is outside. Whatever, all the democratic practices that happened around the neighborhood and everything, even the democratic economics, where I know in most Africans, neighbors borrow from each other, you know, anything from salt to oil and anything else. And people discuss everything. You discuss with your neighbors, you discuss with your neighbors, everything. I talk about that later on. So, in a sense, these indices have some problems. Let me just summarize these problems for you, what I see it as a problem with these indices. Do I have time?
Yes, you do.
Okay. Now, for me, at least, I want to talk about at least four conclusions related to these indices. The indices are state-centric, focusing on how citizens' rights are forsaken or granted or not granted, respected or not respected by the state as they are codified in the jurisdiction of the state. That is the legislative state, okay? They are state-centric. You think that it is the way citizens respond to the state policies. So, mean that the indices inform us that if we take it from a state-centric view, the indices informs us that the state has failed to discharge of its duties, facilitating and reinforcing rather than flouting the rules of the democratic game. Because the rules of the democratic game are flouted by the state. It's not flouted by citizens. Citizens go to vote. You know, there is sometimes high voter turnout, but their votes are taken from one box and put on the other. How can I blame citizens for the decline of democracy? This is my first point. The second point is that there is a priori assumption that the institutional politics and organized civic organizations are the only spaces where democracy is practiced, thus ignoring the pervasive nature of politics, which permits the totality of human activities and existence. What people discuss in their neighborhood or wherever they are about environment, about climate change, about women issues, about youth issues, about the town, whether it is clean or dirty or whatever, products, whether to use plastic or not use plastic, all of these debates, for me, these are democratic debates. You cannot write them off because this is the citizens' domains of spaces of practicing politics. Yeah, of course, many Africans don't have that, but if there is a birds club around here, you know, the leadership of the bird club does not just go around and change all the rules. They have to bring all their members and discuss, and then they change the rules, just as anything else. The same with Africa. You know, you cannot start expanding your farm without talking to your chief and to working to your neighbors and to working to everybody else to reach a settlement. You can, You can extend it as this side by this, but we give you land on the other side. So there is politics outside institutional politics. Of course, some of you as students of sociology and politics, you know what Foucault says about politics. Now, those who claim that democracy has declined assume that institutional democracy and conventional representative democracy, not only as the only spaces of democratic expression, but all other spaces of democratic expression are irrelevant. They don't count. You can be democratic as you want. Okay? And the last one, number four, if the claim that democracy is declining is true, the introductory remarks that I made show that democratic decline is not linear. It's not just going like this. It's not that democracy is declining. It's not just going down like this. Democracy also, if you see what we talk about between the two world wars and all these periods that people said even democracy ended or the death of democracy, it was not linear, like this or like that. It is like this. It goes up and down. And for me, I have no doubt that democracy will resurrect and thrive again. It is a bad period for democracy. Why? Because, of course, you have a crisis of the state. The state is dysfunctional. It's not responding to citizens' demands. Okay. Now, with these four, let me go to the last part of the lecture. Do I have time? Because I can go very fast. I wish people wouldn't like, but I will do that. I have time? Okay. Yeah, no, I'm fine. I can 5-6 minutes, I can finish. Okay, because I don't want also to talk for a long time and explain. I think people here know what I'm talking about. So I want to talk about four areas that I can see them. Democracy is still alive and kicking, maybe declining, but it is resilient, and I am sure that it is coming up. The first area is that related to voter turnout. Now, small or large, high or low, voter turnout is not a good measure for the health of democracy. It might show that there are problems, but it's not a good measure. Why? By the way, the world has seen that the highest turnout out, the people who vote, it is, you see, you take the number, the total number of the voting age, divide them by the people who voted actually, and multiply it by 100. It gives you the vote. Okay. Meaning that, if you look very carefully, you find that the people, the largest number of people who voted during authoritarian regimes. It's very strange. Do you know the last election in Somalia, about 4 or 5 years ago, the voter turnout was 90%. Look at your country, Ethiopia. During the 30 years of the EPRDF, the voter turnout was never less than 80. And the last election, it is 70-something. The European Union, in 2004, the voter turnout was 44%. Last year, they told us the voter turnout was 54%, increased by 10%. It means that it is up and down in countries, but also in continents. So not only that. In fact, even in democracies, people can use legal trickery or legal tricks to prevent people from voting, like what happened in the United States, for instance, with the African Americans. They are really disfranchised as far as voting is concerned. And there are many countries are like that. Certain people, and that can be also socioeconomic. The poor are always disenfranchised. So voting has an economic part of it. I mean, if the polling station is about 10 kilometers, like in our situation in Africa, 10 or 15 kilometers from your village, would you put your transport to feed your people, or you put your money transport to go and vote and come back? Or what is the other alternative? Is one of the political parties come with the cars and take you to vote for it? Probably give you lunch or dinner. So this voter, but also we should not trivialize it. Why? Because if I am a politician, low voter turnout will make me question, and in fact will make me frightened. Where do I draw my legitimacy from? And where those people who do not vote, where do they relocate their political energy? If it is not in the domain that legitimizes the state and gives the state legitimacy. Because I believe that people who walk away from the democratic transition or withdraw from institutional politics do allocate politics in political spaces that matter to them. The fact that people did not vote does not mean that they are not interested in democracy. Maybe they see that the state is not responsive. You go and vote and vote and vote and vote, and the issues coming and the political programs and God knows what. In the middle of the way, the political parties, the majority party, completely change its mind and come with new policies that you are against. It means that even the democracy lost the little honor that it has to make it function. So I want to talk about, this is when, there is the second area, that I think that the emergence of politically active and expanding local and grassroots deliberative democracies in Africa. For instance, in 2015, and I give you figures, whether I myself believe them or not, but I have some positive vibe about it, it is estimated that, or it was estimated that, local government political executives are elected in 80% of the African continent, where more than 60% of the population live. So the majority of the people vote in local elections in issues that are close to their heart. The turnover here is much higher than national politics. Local government authorities and elected legislatures exhibited, according to the report, exhibited better transparency, citizen participation, democratic and legislative practices than the central government or the state institution at the center. People are doing better. Why? Because if the money for the school is eaten by somebody, you know that your child might not go to school. So you go and raise issues and complain. That's why, of course, maybe because countries like Kenya established this district development funds, which they put this money with members of parliament and the local community to these committees to observe where this money goes and all of that. Now, whether it goes to the people or not, it is that even the central government thinks that the people at the local level better manage their affairs and their money than us here at the center. That's the decentralization. Processes started. Not only that, during the 90s, when the public service delivery institutions of the state were almost bankrupt during the structural adjustment, they call it the period of the economic crisis, the greatest economic crisis of Africa. We call it the lost decade for Africa, you know, 80s and the beginning of the 90s, the lost decade. People withdrew from state institutions and began to organize themselves. They said this state is useless. If you want, of course, they started with a partnership with the state of building the school, cost sharing. But in certain areas where, certain areas where people have resources, they started building their own school, sometimes even having their own teachers. The state pay the teacher's salary, but they build the school. All different kinds of arrangements with whatever you think about. Not only that, democratic practices of civic engagement have expanded. both in rural and urban local communities in Africa. For example, indigenous and modern or state local institutions coexist side by side in Ghana, in Kenya, in Malawi, in Botswana. Of Botswana, you know that there is a council of chiefs in the parliament and so on and so forth. Even with Mozambique, with all its trouble, locally people do things. I mean, you know, it has now a war with the Shabab and things like that, but still people complain about democracy in Mozambique, but locally people are doing things. And they did not happen just because out of the behest of the state. No, people struggled for that until they got it. People struggled for that. I mean, one of the reasons why Mozambique went to the civil war in 2013, partly, is because of this lack of democracy. So therefore, just to finish this section, deliberation at the local level are not only about service delivery, but also about other things that are of concern to people. They involve youth, involve women, farmers, pastoralists, traders, and everybody else, non-governmental organizations. And they are hybrid. They are both local and international. Many global NGOs participate and try to encourage people through their programs, you know, to do these things now. The third one, and I'm coming there, the expanding role of social media and cyber democracy. And I skip a lot of this, but I go immediately to what I wanted to say here. The emergence of local, national, regional, and globally networked interest groups using social media to debate social issues of great significance online has ushered in an era of unprecedented global interaction. So it is within Africa, but also globally. If people were executed by the state in country A today, by tomorrow or after tomorrow, this issue probably will be discussed in the American Congress or in the European Union or in other forums that are in other parts of the world to highlight the issue of human rights abuse. So, but this is not democracy because it's not part of institutional politics. The last one, before I conclude, the fourth, expansion of private TV and radio broadcasting as spaces of cyber democracy and political mobilization. You see, nowadays, I don't know, within the last 20 years, you would never hear about any uprising, youth uprising, or anybody uprising or organizing against the state without the role of the social media and this privately broadcasting, from the latest in Sudan to the others. In Ethiopia, the changes have happened, so on and so forth. If you go to all of these countries, the use of private TV station. Just to give you some sense of the expansion of that. In 2000, it was estimated that there were 600 TV broadcasters in Africa. All of them probably, except a few in South Africa, are owned by the state. All of them, okay? But by 2020, there is 1,500 TV and radio stations owned by the private sector, political parties, opposition or not, interest groups working on environment, women issues, youth issues, all different kinds of issues. The big, there is also the huge expansion of radio stations. Radio station is no longer that expensive thing that the radio of the government, you have several buildings connected with each other. You can have a radio station from your room. That's digital radios. Digital radios, now we are told that there are 4,500 stations, but there are more than that in terms of FM digital radios. If you are taking your taxi from any African country before you arrive your hotel, you will listen to these digital radios. The majority of these digital radios, which are spreading not only democratic values, but also other values related to societal issues, the news and all of that, you know, with big audience. There is also a very major shift in the digital radios. the use of local languages instead of foreign languages. It's not English and not French or the major language in the country. So in Nigeria, it's not only English, but you have them in Hausa, you have them in Ugbu, you have them in Fulani, you have them in many others. Even political parties and public interest groups are also using these radios and all of that. So let me conclude this section. What is happening? It has become also a norm that authoritarian and semi-authoritarian regimes block the internet. Immediately block the internet whenever they see that there is people are mobilizing against them. When they see that there is heavy traffic about an issue that the government doesn't want people to discuss, what do? They lock the internet. And of course, Africa is shown as one of the worst in terms of internet blockage by the state. Now, is this a problem of decline of democracy or the decline of the state? Or the state is the one that is blocking democracy. So we have to, you know, you have to set that that record. Conclusion, number one, democracy is expanding in new spaces and taking new forms, complementing rather than replacing representative democracy. We do not say that representative democracy is dead, but alone it's not enough. Where have I gone? My second conclusion is that the so-called decline of democracy always happens during times of crisis. As we have seen, 37, 75, the Watergate, the Trump presidency, for instance, has somehow coincided with that. Therefore, the last minute, it is plausible to conclude that the moment the state, the cronies of the state, and the self-serving political elite shape up and respect the democratic rules that they themselves are supposed to be their guardians, democracy will rebound. It will come again. So if the state is restructured to serve citizen interests and become responsive to their legitimate demands, you will surely be lamenting on the rebirth of democracy rather than the decline of democracy. Thank you for your attention.